establish the modernist vision or modernism as a movement in Pakistan? Why didn't they revert to the tradition that was indigenous, that belonged to us? Why did they have to look up to the West for a new visual idiom?
As far as the Zubaydah Agha and both Shakir Ali are concerned, the times that they decided to come back were are considered to be modern times. And Shakir Ali, having been trained in the modernist style of studio art, and so was Zubaydah Agha, and coming back to a more craft-related environment in Pakistan, I think it did not gel very well with their kind of training. And like we were talking before, that it is most of the art, I think, from the 60s onwards in Pakistan, and especially from academic institutions like NCA or the Punjab School. Punjab School still, I think, maintain, I think Dr. Saiba will be able to elaborate on that, still maintained a line towards tradition, and you have beautiful pictures being created. Whereas I think Shakir Ali and Zubaydah Agha both looked at it from a humanistic point of view and were both critical and analytical point of view, I think, which was lacking in art in Pakistan. And it resonated well with the younger generation of the time. They did, of course, face a lot of resistance, but I think eventually modernism prevailed. And
however, the expression was alien to the environment in the beginning. So what exactly was the original response to the new idiom? You said that it ranked well, it fared well with the younger generation.
Eventually. I think people had to be trained. Like you said, you mentioned Chughtai Sahib for one, okay, who broke away from the Bengal school. And I think he but stuck on to the, he never applied the modernist idiom to his art, at least of the 60s. Yeah. Whereas when Shakir Ali came along, and the whole technique of preparing the canvas the way it was, and bringing in a different view from a traditional point of view, which was the Ustad Shagird tradition, okay, which Chughtai Sahib also held on to for some time. And I think the Shakir Ali is that breaking away the chains of art being more of a craft rather than, and more of a documentation of traditional crafts rather than art for the sake of art, which modernity dictated. I think that's where the change resonated with people. And why? More and more people, I think the international scene, by that time the Biennale was also in progress, where America was prevailing upon the world to, or the academies, to change their view towards art and architecture. The Bauhaus played a very important role, yes. And then eventually all the modernist movements, I mean, Paris would have been very vibrant in the 60s, breaking away all kinds of norms that traditional European art held. And Shakir Ali brought that thought into Pakistan.
So while people like Haji Sharif, Sheikh Shuja'ullah, Ustad Bashiruddin and others were also producing miniature art, again at the Mayo School of Art, which later on became the National College of Arts in Lahore, why was there such a mitigated interest in miniature making? Was it being looked upon merely as a craft, as replication? Until in the late 80s and the early 90s it came to be contemporized or modernized, if you may like. So until miniature making was modernized, it didn't enjoy much interest and following in Lahore. Why is that so? I mean, what do you blame that on?
I think it was also an awareness amongst the populace and the populist movements which were sort of gearing up towards giving agency to the artist of producing what he was and not being dictated. People like people who stuck to tradition art, okay, was purely representative of the kind of tradition that they were sort of taught to follow by their ustad and not deviate from it. Not even a single spot should not deviate from it. Whereas modernist art gives you that freedom to deviate from it. And it's a different form of expression. I mean, expressionism, I would say that your emphasis on color, on shapes, on forms, to express the same kind of things that maybe Haji Sharif was trying to express also through his miniature. But miniature would not appeal to, I think, the contemporary generations that were following, that were going to the Mayo School of Art and later the National College of Art.
Oh, you mean to the bourgeoisie?
The bourgeoisie would be one, yeah. But I think beyond bourgeoisie too, people wanted to go into art. We would not have the likes of Bashir Mirza, and we would not have the likes of Ahmed Parvez, and we would not have the likes of any of the other modernist painters had it not been the first steps taken by Shakir Ali. I think that kind of modernist thought that he brought in was a revolution. It was different from what was being taught at Punjab University. I think in many ways it was different. So,
why the inception of modern art had become so significant and almost indispensable to the East? Why couldn't one look for the role models in the tradition that one had left behind, or the tradition that was sort of scattered?
Asim, I would like to say here that art is always a product of its time.
True.
And when miniature painting was being taught at the time of Haji Sharif and, you know, Ustad Shujaullah, so mainly it was copies, you know, which were being made, and the students were being asked to make copies of either Mughal paintings or Persian paintings, etc. And I think there was a strong realization that what the students are doing was actually imitating the past. And how can that be a viable expression of the contemporary times? Mm-hmm. And I think that debate took on between the, at NCA, between the teachers who were of the traditional bent of mind and those with a modernist trend. And the beneficiaries, of course, were the students, because out of that debate came the new miniature movement. So, and the other thing which I think needs to be highlighted is that art has many dimensions. You can't say that modern art is only human or representational art is not human. That is not the case. If you look at Khalid Iqbal's paintings, which In simple words, you can say they are representational landscape painting.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you know, if you have an eye for that, and if you have an affinity for that kind of art, you can go deep down into the philosophy of his art, and you can feel actually there's a spiritual connection in that work. So being human is at every level. And if we take the difference between say Karachi or Lahore or Punjab for that matter, so Punjab has its own environs. Punjab has been surrounded by, you know, fields and trees, and greenery is aplenty. And the pace of life has also been a bit slow over there compared to cosmopolitan Karachi, where there has always been a need for the abstract, you know, a more opportunity for that kind of work. Whereas in the Punjab, you'll find people like Colin David, people like Saeed Akhtar, people like Khalid Iqbal, Iqbal Hussain, Ijaz ul Hassan, Mustafa, you know, so many who have, you know, focused on the figure or the landscape. And that's a different kind of vision which has come across. And through the representational work, you can bring about, you can focus on social issues, like in the work of Iqbal Hussain. I mean, he has drawn attention to the plight of those particular women. So so art, as I see it, it has, and especially being a teacher of art, I think one needs to have an appreciation, you know, for all sorts of styles or thinking which is there. And you should kind of accept that here, unfortunately, as somebody else in the morning session mentioned, that there are lobbies. And actually, lobbies have kind of, you know, done a bit of a damage to the progress of art. The acceptance has to be there that, okay, if this kind of art is, you know, avant-garde or modern, then this kind of art is also acceptable and equally pertinent to the times. And back to your question, which was regarding at the time of partition, as we know, there were just two main institutions from where art came out. It was the National College of Arts and the Punjab University. At the National College of Arts, which was earlier on as a crafts school, it became a college in around 1958 when Shakir Ali took over as the principal. And then the story of modernism and all that starts. Whereas with the Punjab University, that became a department in 1940, and Anna Molka Emmerd, who was the founder of that department, had come from England. She had had her training in the Royal College of Art in London. And she, when she came here, she brought with her, you know, all the aesthetics which were prevalent there. So that is why at Punjab University, because she herself was trained in, you know, book illustration, in printmaking, in painting, in drawing. So that is what the curriculum pertained to at the university. And the interest in the observable was injected in the students, you know, to study, to look at it. But having said that, if you look at the painters who have come out of the Punjab University, you will see a diversity of style. You can see Nagori, who was, you can say, very, very modernist. You can see Ghulam Rasool with his flat kind of landscapes. You can see Colin David was from the university. Khalid Iqbal was from the university. Lala Rukh was from the university, Ijaz Ul Hassan, Ijaz Anwar, exactly. Yeah. So, you know, there has been a diversity, and one should, I don't think it should be grouped together as one style. I feel that way. And of course, I mean, we have, you know, we've had our bad times Punjab University has been under severe political intervention by a religious party, and that has been detrimental to the growth, you know, in many ways. I remember when I was a student, it had a very open atmosphere. And then we have the Zia period, where there was suppression, repression, and interference. And then onwards, the students who would have come to the fine arts department, students from, say, educated families, they all opted for the National College of Arts. And that is how you see the National College of Art, you know, attaining more distinction, and the Punjab University, you know,
but
going down.
But why has the University of the Punjab Department of Fine Arts been always sort of accused of perpetuating a rather academic style of painting and sculpture making? At the same time, most of the members of the Punjab Artists Association, for that matter, are a product of the same university department.
Well, not really. Mustafa, Kaleem Khan, Zulfi, they are all NCA products. It's a mix. But you can say it's a school of thought, maybe. And as far as the thing that why is it more academic, actually since the department has been affiliated with the university, so you had to fulfill the university criteria of this other part of, you know, giving importance to the theoretical as well. Whereas at NCA it was more the
practical.
Yes, it was on more the practical. So that has been, and then NCA has been under the federal government. It has had more freedom. It has been away from, you know, the people who can control it. Whereas Punjab University is situated right in Lahore under the Punjab government, under the influence of all these parties, you know, who have played havoc. But well, it has survived all that, and you have wonderful artists coming out of it again.
So I would like to ask Taimur, something here.
I just wanted to add one aspect. You asked about academic painting. You must remember, 60s was a time of other social sciences movements that we call structuralism and post-structuralism, and people like Derrida and all these philosophers, Roland Barthes, they all had a different way of looking at things, which I'm sure influenced Chakir Ali and Zubeda Agha at that time, whether they liked it or not. Dr. Saiba just pointed out that it is problematic when political institution and Punjab University, coming from a structuralist background, coming from a background where everything has to have a hierarchical kind of thing. I'm not saying that NCA doesn't have it. Of course, NCA has it too, but not with the same intensity as Punjab University would have it, because it's part and parcel of a lot of other academic disciplines. And I find that stifling in many ways. I mean, I'm teaching in an institution where there are several other disciplines, and media sciences, supposedly very postmodernist, contemporary, okay, but we have to comply with whatever the other departments are doing as well. It may seem like computer sciences and social sciences and other departments like mechatronics and law have no bearing on media sciences. Media sciences is independent. It's not. When push comes to shove, the curriculum that is being taught and the way what the students are being taught is a percentage of it is what you can do yourself. I'm sure Chakir Ali faced the same dilemma. And the rest of it is dictated by the federal government. that so much modernity can come in, so much, and then the whole idea of creating lobbies. I mean, that was a new kind of way of looking at art education too. The galleries today play a very important part in forming the curricula for fine arts.
So, talking about the artists' collectives, they've been exhibitions, they've been associations, which, in my opinion, have been celebrating regionalism and provincialism and territorialism. So what do artist collectives like artists from Sindh, artists from KPK, artists from GB Baltistan, a collection of an assembly of artists coming from the Punjab, put together, herded up, shown in various important venues, from the Alhambra in Lahore to the Frere Hall in Karachi to private art galleries mean to you? What do they end up promoting? A culture of regionalism and territorialism and provincialism as opposed to cosmopolitanism?
I think territorialism would be a very harsh word to use for the kind of artists that are being produced by the artists from Sindh, Balochistan and Gilgit-Baltistan and all the regions which do not belong to Punjab. I think NCA has done a wonderful job as far as amalgamating and creating, I don't know, for want of a better word, I would say,
I didn't have a choice.
nationalism. Kind of,
it's a nationalized institution.
Yes,
I didn't have a choice.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that milieu has kind of created a huge understanding of art in even the urban centers, where you only thought that people from the bourgeoisie could come in and become artists, and people who were in the periphery could not move into it. I think what NCA and to a certain extent Punjab University has done has brought in people from the periphery into the mainstream art. And that art historical movement, we don't owe it to any movements as the Western art does.
Having said that, that doesn't quite answer my question. My question was about the new ethos and the new culture that such exhibitions aim to spawn.
Yeah.
So what do they achieve out of that?
I think, Asim, this is like you, if you look at the government level, now you, earlier on we had HEC, you know, one body.
Yeah.
Now you have HECs in different provinces, offices of the HEC. And similar, cricket is a best example where they are having matches, you know, between different provinces. So I think it's an effect of that. But I don't think one should see it that way. Yeah.
I mean, I can not answer directly to your question in that way. But for instance, film has been taught in a traditional form. The film format, the 16mm, okay, but and analog camera, okay, and but today film is being taught in the digital medium, and like my colleague just pointed out, that HEC has a huge part to play in that. Today, I, as an institution, I'm looking at NCA because it's producing filmmakers as artists. And those are the kind of people I'm looking at to come and teach our students. But not because I want to teach digital filmmaking, but it is more a question of what HEC is telling me to do. Okay? And HEC is saying, no, you have to take people from other provinces. You have to take people from Balochistan, you have to take people from Punjab, and maybe Punjab is also under that kind of pressure to take on people from Sindh, Balochistan. In Indus Valley, we were always under pressure to take students from Punjab and from rural Punjab, not urban Punjab, but and take students from rural Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and Balochistan. And the government used to assist us that these are the students and they are very talented and they should be allowed to sit for the exam. And in Zavis's case, the government pays for them to come and study in Karachi from Punjab. They can easily go to NCA, but the government wants that kind of thing. So in terms of art historical terms, I think you the documenter who's doing this, would he refer it to as a movement? Or it's not homegrown in that sense?
But that's absolutely fine. But then talking about the exhibitions which are mounted around such a regional identity is what does not quite justify its agenda. I mean, how should you qualify art from Sindh?
Yeah.
I mean, anybody who is born in Sindh is a Sindhi artist, or anybody who speaks Sindhi is a Sindhi artist, or anybody who talks about the culture of Sindh is a Sindhi artist.
Yeah.
I mean, what exactly qualifies you as an artist from Sindh in case you decide to make an exhibition out of this topic?
I think it would more to do with the institution that you're coming from previously or the kind of background. Maybe you're coming from Sindh. But yes, ethnicity would be defined by the language that you speak, the culture that you want to represent, the kind of imagery that you make, okay, would not be related to something from Punjab. What they leave that to Punjab University students to do that. But going to NCA would mean that they have the freedom of amalgamating their own ethnic identity with the and the modernist tool is used, and which is why they're displayed in Alhambra as Sindhi, ethnic Sindhi artists. But they may not, they may have come from Sindh, but they've adopted the new ways that the institution.
So you end up wearing the badge of your regional identity on your sleeve.
In some ways,
and
yes.
And flaunt it.
Yes. Yes, but if Shakir Ali, going from Pakistan and studying art in an academy in Paris, would that make him ethnic Pakistani artist? He would not. He would be representing the academy that he's coming from. Similarly, if somebody is going to St. Martin's or going to the Royal College of Art or the Royal Institute of Art in England, they would not say he's from Pakistan. Shazia Sikandar was not flaunted as a Pakistani artist initially. Okay, she was flaunted coming from an American institution, but talking about ethnicity. So she wasn't wearing her ethnicity on her sleeve. Okay, but
so,
that kind
so
of.
So are you Taimur Suri the artist or the Pakistani artist?
That would be very difficult. I think it would be Taimur Suri the artist in today's times. 20 years ago, I may have questioned that.
So it won't be enough for you to be recognized merely as an artist, international at that?
Yeah.
Would you still like to be known as a Pakistani artist?
No, I would not like that kind of Pakistani label. I don't know. I mean, whenever I gave talks as a student, and even after graduation, the only time I was introduced as a Pakistani art historian, training to be an Islamic art historian, was when we were presented to the Queen, and they said, he's from Pakistan, because the rest of the class was all multicultural. Somebody was from Morocco, somebody was from Palestine, Switzerland, Germany, but they didn't mention them. They didn't mention their identity. They mentioned mine.
But you know,
I would like to quote what Chughtai once said. He said that in order to be universal, you have to be rooted in your own culture. And you know, we have to pay heed to this because of this technological advancement and because of the globalization. I don't know 30 years hence what the scene would be. It's very difficult to predict, or maybe it is easy to predict, because the amount of communication that we have now, I don't know. I shudder to think actually what it would be like, you know. So despite that, I think where you belong to, what your roots are, where you come from, that is so very important. And that is what art institutions should be teaching to their students. There's a lot of problem these days because of this internet accessibility. You know, students don't go through that proper process of investigating, of learning. It's just lifting and, you know,
superficial.
So it's superficial.
If I may ricochet you back to the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, if you like, to the times of Zia's martial law, is that the period when the female voice came to be heard in visual art for the first time in Pakistan? And I mean there has not been a feminist movement in art in Pakistan per se, but the female voice came to be heard, at least it was loud enough to be heard in visual art, in visual culture, in Pakistan during the times of repression. Do you agree with that?
Yes, I think to a great extent. But also, I think the times were changing and there was greater awareness as far as the women were concerned. Earlier on, they had just been restricted to teaching, but now they were practitioners, they were teachers, they were more career-oriented. So that was also one reason, apart from the fact that the feminist movement abroad, you know, in the West, was also one aspect which influenced these women artists.
You'd like to add something?
No, I don't know. We never really had a feminist movement like in the West, and I don't think culturally women would be allowed to have that kind of thing, because our culture is rooted on different values from the West. Okay, so yes, imitation to a certain extent. When you say that 80s, you would consider artists like Lala Rukh, was it? Yeah, I mean, coming out and being beaten for being an artist by the police, and freedom of expression was being violated upon. And yes, I think in that respect, yes. But we've had some brilliant female artists throughout, from the 50s right down to the contemporary, and a complete control over the medium, complete control over their end game, what they want to achieve.